Futures and options on futures trading involve substantial risk and is not a suitable investment for all types of investors. Past results are not necessarily indicative of future results. When I use the word I in this video, it refers to what I teach in my charting course or what I offer in my twice daily oral and written updates. Prices shown on charts and quote boards are in real time and take into account all known activity up to this point in time. And if you'd like to read more of this disclaimer, simply hit the pause key on your video player.
Good day, all. Ira Epstein of Linn Associates with your financial market wrap-up, and this is for Monday, the 3rd of December, 2018. As you're watching TV right now, you're probably seeing the funeral of former President George H.W. Bush. Our best to him. Good president. In looking at the markets, a strong up day, but not as strong as it could have been. You know, if you read the Chinese press, they're not playing this the same way that President Trump played it. There's no mention yet on their part, at least that we can find here, of auto tariffs dropping off from 40% to 15%. Maybe they will, maybe they won't. If you take a look at grains, they gave up the best part of the day. They got up beans. You know, you would think that's one of the big commodities that they said they're going to buy a substantial amount of. Up 11 cents isn't all that impressive. That could have been a lot more. Remember, we're not talking anything but U.S. beans that they said they were going to buy. That didn't bring out anything unless the farmer was there with both hands when the market rallied up about 30 cents. Gold market, I think corn because I'm thinking gold color there, up very nicely along with most of the metals. But don't think this is where copper actually is. Copper finished the day, if you were watching the last 10 minutes of trading, closer to about 60, 70 points higher on the day. It gave up quite a bit of those gains. I watch copper because it's called Dr. Copper. It's a good barometer of what's going on between the U.S. and China because 50% of the world's copper is consumed by China. Another market that had a strong performance, they were the energy markets. You have an OPEC meeting in Vienna. It starts this Thursday. We'll see what goes on there. And as for Brexit, I want you to remember that tomorrow starts a five-day debate at Parliament on this, and we'll see what goes on there about it. When we look at a weekly area chart of closes, the one good thing is Santa Trump, I'm calling him, gave the market a reason to boost, and it's up 32 points for the week. This is where the market finished off last year, so that looks pretty good so far. Good gain. The other thing that's impressive is we hadn't been up to these levels since back at the beginning of November. We had crashed, if you will, going from 2820 down to nearly 2620, and now we've made it all the way back up, so it's been a nice rally. This is a resistance box. I like to call these boxes from this level to this level, that to that. Close over the 2820, and I'll get rid of this Fibonacci, then we're high enough where that's off the pattern. You're back into the top level of the bounce that are called the waves within the Fibonacci numbers. As you take a look at swing lines, I'm going to call this a vertical price rise. If you look at this market, it's come straight from 26.26 all the way up to today's high of 28.14, nearly a 200 point rally. It's not the easiest thing to catch, number one. Number two, it's runaway. And number three, there are some gaps. If you look at today's low in the chart of 27.73.50, and we go to the high of Friday at 27.64, you have about a 9-point gap. Gaps don't often stay open on charts. So somewhere along the line here, maybe with what we call a Tuesday reversal, the market backs off a little bit. Remember that on Wednesday at 8:30 in the morning, at the CME group at least, the futures market for equity indexes will close. Treasuries won't even open. All other futures markets are open. So it's only those, and that's in respect to President Bush. So as the market's looking here, I wouldn't be surprised to get a bit of backing and filling going into that period where the cash, New York Stock Exchange, NASDAQ, they're closed, and the futures are going to be closed. So that could happen. As we look at moving averages, what you did is you leapfrogged today over the 200-week average. That leaves the 100-week as your resistance. Support back at the 200-day, obviously, your first support level. Second would be the 100. As you look at Bollinger Bands, I see strong resistance in the neighborhood now of the 100-week average at 2818 and the upper Bollinger Band at 2833. I'm expecting pros to take some money off the table. As we look at momentum, I'm backing myself up with that thought because you're overbought instantly. Any reading in the slow stochastic over 70, at least that's how I teach it, is overbought. The traditional is 80-20. I don't go with the traditional ways on that. In the NASDAQ, you rallied up to the first resistance in this chart, which is the 200-day average. This is how you looked on Friday, and you get your gap in here too, so I won't be surprised to see these markets over the next couple of days try to fill gaps. That's very typical. The trend here is up, unlike the S&P, of higher lows, higher highs. Support back at 68.45. The dilemma is with this chart pattern, we knew we'd get into something like this either way that the market went. Because you have a vertical price rise, where do you put a stop if you buy it? That becomes your biggest problem. In the Dow, here too, if we go to Friday, we stopped at the 100-day moving average of closes. If you could exceed that, maybe the Bollinger Band becomes the next resistance. You can see that that's still a possibility. And like the other markets, if we look at the low of today of 25,685 and the high of Friday, 25,602, you've got about a 40-point gap in there. And from where you're at, that's a good ways off in this market. So it's 200-point decline almost. As you look at the Russell, it finally is back positive for the year. So yeah, for a lot of people, they're able to say the market's up for me again, based on the indices, obviously. But here too, I have an overbought reading. So I have a common thing. I have overbought markets. This chart looks better than some of the others because at least if one is buying in this pullback area, let's assume 1521, the risk factor at 1484 is not as big as some of the other risk factors. That's all that you can say with it. In the VIX cash, drop down into the lower Bollinger Band of 1567, and by the way, the 100-week average is there, and I fully expect that you're going to get it from me. Put writers are going to show up looking for a bounce back to the 18-day average of closes. That's what I'd expect. In the T-bond market, remember, we've moved over to the marches. You don't want to be in indices any longer. The market has still got an uptrend up to the upper Bollinger Band with an embedded reading. What takes over now on the chart is not the price. It's the embedded reading. Until it's lost on pullbacks, I would expect to see buyers. If and when it's lost, then I look for prices to start a roll, maybe back to the 18-day average. Right now, you haven't begun losing that reading, nor in the 10-year note. So these are still bullish. Gold could be the 119.31 level. Remember, we have an FOMC meeting coming up. We have the Bank of Canada this week going to announce its policies as well. TLT. Put on a nice bull move. It is overbought, not embedded like the other readings. You don't have both numbers going sideways that make up the slow stochastic over 80, but you do have the pattern of higher lows, higher highs. A bull trap and possibly an end to this whole rally would happen by taking out either tomorrow or, I guess it's Thursday since you're not going to be open Wednesday, this low. Then I'd have the 18-day average back in the site for support. In the dollar index, notice that you've got a pattern of lower highs and higher lows. You're narrowing in the trading range. The battleground, pretty clear, the 18-day average of closes. Momentum is not leading price. It's just flat in the water. I'll define the trend is up because the legacy is first higher lows and higher highs, but I don't ignore that you've just made lower highs. In fact, if you take out 96.54.5 and don't take out 97.24, the pattern turns bearish. You'd keep your lower highs, lower lows, but you'd have a new low under the 18-day average, potentially putting the lower Bollinger Band into the game. What does it mean in plain English? The bulls have to defend it and not let that happen on the chart. In the euro, it's a flip-flop of it. you've got the pattern of lower highs, but you flipped it now. Now you got the higher lows. So to keep bearish, you got to get the bears to shove you back under the 113.18 level. If you get over 114.15.5, the bulls take control and you put the upper Bollinger Band in. Again, just like in the dollar index, you're not getting a first glimpse of what momentum wants to do. Often momentum leads price. In this case, and the dollar index just sort of drifting sideways. In the British pound, everything still looks bearish. Lower highs, lower lows, under the 18-day average. And in the momentum, both numbers under 20 today, both under 20 on Friday, and both under 20 on Thursday. Therefore, you have 3 days in a row, you got an embedded reading. When and if the red line closes over 20, it'll be a sign that price wants to return potentially to the 18-day average. Until that occurs, I look for this market to line up and try to get to that lower Bollinger Band. In the Japanese yen, we have a market that's got a pattern of lower highs, lower lows. Bearish, momentum down, but it is oversold. So selling fresh into an oversold condition is often difficult. You either embed eventually or you correct that by playing around that 18-day average or higher. In Bitcoin, the embedded reading is right in place. This market, to me, this was a pause. This market still looks to me like lower prices can easily be handled in it. I'm looking here at the potential of the $3,000 range. I'll be on TikTok on Bloomberg tomorrow talking about Bitcoin. If you're looking at the Brent versus WTI crude, you can see I've gone from 1018 to 829 and a little bit of a bounce. That's all that you can say. If you take a look at price action, and I always look at where the slow stochastics are, you lost the bearish embedded reading. This is a sign that the pros will now cover their shorts, looking for price to return to the 18-day average of closes. I'd be wrong if you re-embed prices by dropping them hard tomorrow. When I come over to WTI crude, you lost the embedded reading there as well. I'm going to look for the same thing, price in the 18-day average to come together. In plain English, as far as I'm concerned as a chartist, this break is over. So it's the first time I'm saying that, you finally lost the embedded reading. As I come over to rebob gasoline, it's the same thing. I see the break as being over right now and prices wanting to return to this 151 level, the 18-day average of closes, and I stay that way on the energies and this as long as those embedded readings tomorrow don't return. After tomorrow, I don't care. They'd have to have 3 new days of staying under 20. Tomorrow's the only day they can get it back. It took a much longer time than I thought when we had gotten the signal that momentum had come out of Nat Gas to return to the 18-day average of closes, but return it has. So now the market, as far as I'm concerned, is neutral. The fact that it took that long is a friendly sign, not a bearish sign. There is no trend because you got a higher high, lower low. You return to the 18-day average the first time since the very beginning of November. This tightness, and you learn to look for that on a chart, is what propelled this market higher. As you can see, the boards behind me have cleared. Everybody's going to get ready, and I'm going to try to take advantage with my live webinar. Now, I believe I've got it scheduled for this Wednesday. I'm going to send out another invite in the morning. If you're on my mailing list, you'll get it. If I've taken you off for any number of reasons, you're not going to get it. You can't get in without the password. When you sign up, you'll get the invite. You first sign up, then an email will be sent to you with your password. It begins at 12:30 p.m. this Wednesday, which I think is an advantage for us with the S&P not being open and the stock and the Treasuries. Why not take advantage of the day? I won't be as pressured and I'll be able to answer and keep this open longer than normal. How do you get it? Call my staff, 866-973-2077. They will send you out the invite. Barring that, you'll get it in the email from me. There's nowhere to sign up for it on the website. So it's one of the two ways. You have a great day. I'm Ira Epstein.